Do you know the movie I'm talking about?
I do. So anyways, but we have Kelly Nicole with Infected.
Yeah, oh yeah, this is a great song. This is my 12-year-old son's favorite song.
All right. Well, here it is.
This is Infected. I was Infected, one of my favorite songs out the album. And it is my son. And actually, Theresa met my son, who loves the song Infected. When I was playing that song over and over, like a year or two ago, he's like, play that song that has that India sounding, you know, at the beginning. Whatever.
And you know what? I mean, for me, tonight was like the first night that I've heard any of these songs. So, I love that song. That was awesome.
Yeah, man. Well, that's some real authentic shit there. Like, that's a for real sitar. They tuned it up. It doesn't have a regular scale like a guitar, like our Western scale. So that's some advanced chemistry right there.
Well, cool. I mean, the sitar is like, it's an amazing instrument. So.
Oh yeah. Thank you, Beatles.
Yeah.
Yes, exactly.
No, but that's... I mean,
gotta
yeah,
love the Beatles.
The Beatles. No, yeah, yeah. The you're Beatles. Right. You have to say Beatles. There's no
Beatles.
There's no T in...
No one wants to hear
again,
me do that.
The Beatles.
When you're trying to talk European, you know, European, I'm a P-an, everyone's a P-an. You gotta say you can't say a T. You gotta say Beatles like that, right? It's like rock and roll. There's no K. There's no.
It's rock and roll.
Rock and roll. I don't know. I'm trying really hard, but that's stupid. Just let's move
the
on.
The other day,
let's move
had
on.
Way too much of the cold cock whiskey tonight. So
no. Oh, there's more. There's more. There's more. I'm getting.
Oh
to
yeah.
That,
so I mean, we definitely have more in the studio with us tonight, but. Speaking of which,
is there another
our
bottle?
Sponsors,
is there another bottle after this one?
Oh God, yes. They actually have you know, surprisingly enough, they've supplied us with cold cock whiskey. We have reached enough listeners where they just send us bottles.
And Dave said he's going to drive me home.
Yeah, no.
Yeah, no.
I've already made it to my house, so I'm good. So you're on your own, Dave.
Yeah, you made it all the way to your house. You already
I did.
But Teresa.
Hey, now, I have like a whole room to make.
I don't understand what you're saying. But Teresa, I didn't understand what he meant. Infected. Do you want to talk about that particular song? I mean, about what it is?
Yeah.
I mean,
well, you know, do you want me to give a little background, introduce the foundation?
Oh, please do.
Context?
Yeah, big time.
Please do.
The context. And even like Kelly's like songwriting. I mean, you know, if she, because I would have loved to have been there for all that because, and we'll get into like, you know, we'll get into how I met you and Kelly and stuff. And how, I mean, I was infected, but with how you guys anyway, just go.
Okay, so, well, this is going to sound a little corporate and cheesy, but we're on a mission here, so I'll just put it like it is. I'm Teresa Holl, no relation to Dave Holl.
The other Holl.
Thank you.
Yeah, exactly. And I'm the executive director of the Kelly Nicole Foundation. Kelly is my wife, my late wife. And we started this roughly the day after she passed, to be honest. She worked her entire life to get her music out there. She had all the opportunities in the world, but struggled with PTSD. And a vicious eating disorder, and opportunity after opportunity was basically just robbed from her by all these health afflictions and the fallout from some difficult trauma earlier in her life. So after seeing all the grit, all the strength, all the hard work, and then having her out of nowhere get this cancer diagnosis 6 months after our honeymoon, you know, when she passed 6 months after that, I just looked around at her producer and her best friend, her music partner, and said, let's go. We've obviously got work to do. So here's the foundation and we're going to release her music. You can buy her music, merchandise, t-shirts, all that, like you'd buy for any band that you love, except everything above our expenses, we're going to donate to support trauma survivors and people with eating disorders. So, you can learn more about it at kellynicole.com. And the easy way to remember is it's just music on a mission. It's great music for a great cause. And I think as you get to know her and listen to the lyrics tonight, you'll know why the mission is what it is. It's very much, you know, she's one of those great all-time autobiographical songwriters who's not afraid to put her heart out there in the music. And as you knew, Dave, I mean, she understood the technical and scientific side of it too. She was her own engineer. A lot of people can handle both sides of the mic, right? There's not a lot of singers and artists who can go out and rewire the studio in their sleep, but she was a rare talent, and we want to make sure that
I'm one of the first. I'm one of the first to admit that I can't. I mean, there's like, yeah. I mean, I for as long as I've played and how many shows I've played in my life, I have musician friends of mine who fucking make fun of me. You know, I mean, they're like, because I don't know. Anything.
You have a co-host that makes fun of you because, I mean, you look at the board and go, oh, my God, that's a lot of red lights.
Yeah, I'm going to press all the I'm going to press all the red buttons and see what happens. Yeah, I mean, yeah, see, I don't know. And everyone says, I mean,
the
like,
red ones. Yeah.
Yeah. They're like, dude, how long have you been playing? And you don't even know what this does. I'm like, you know what? I show up. Tell me what channel to plug in and I'll fucking play. I can play as good as anyone. I just don't know.
Is.
I just don't know.
You know what?
Most
it takes a true
like
musician to actually understand the whole sound side of things. So, I mean, you know, myself personally, I do not know Kelly Nicole. I wish, even based on what I've heard right now, I wish that I would have known her.
Well, if you listen to the album and the words of her bass player, Jason Murray, He said, "This album is so honest. I can hand the Hate Becoming CD over to anyone and say, meet my friend Kelly. Like, it's that true." So I think you'll know her more within an hour.
Oh, I can see that big time, yeah.
Right?
I've known her, all of her lyrics, for like 2 years, and I can totally, seriously, I can totally see what you're talking about.
Yeah, well, I mean, think of all the great music that you love and how many of those people, regrettably, had passed before you even knew the music was out there. Like, people will ask me, well, what are you going to do with the Kelly Nicole Foundation when the market is saturated? There's no more Kelly Nicole fans. And I just kind of say, like, I became a Doors fan in 1992. There's no such thing as no more Kelly Nicole fans. You just keep spreading
it. Well, exactly.
It. And good. The day I die, there'll be a new fan born, and they can just keep it going.
Good music is going to be, it's going to have fans. I mean, good music will have fans.
That's all, dude.
I mean, without a doubt, I mean, no matter what, I mean, new fans are born every single day.
Yep.
And, you know, even with, you know, existing fans, it's all about exposure. And the more you can get everything played, the more fans you're going to get.
Hey, my 12-year-old, who was 10 when he first heard her stuff, he's a big fan. He's like, and my other two boys, I mean, they're, you know, more into sports and stuff like that, whatever, and, you know, whatever. So
blah, 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 sports.
Hey, I am too, but, you know, I mean, I'm one of the few
guys. But you're a loser!
That can do both. Hey, Justin, my 12-year-old, he's an outstanding, he's like the top quarterback in the whole, whatever you call it, youth league. But he loves music, though, and most kids are like, what's on the radio? Oh, that's what's on the radio. Not, hey, I'm going to go and hear something that I've never heard before and determine if I like it or not.
Yeah, make up your own mind, right?
Yes, that's exactly the thing. You know, I mean, just because something's shoved in your face, you know, radio, and back into the day with MTV when they actually used to play music.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They, you know, it's, Dave's dying.
Yep.
Dave just slammed like the last half glass of the Colcock whiskey, and now he's like choking back there. Sally, come on, wimp.
No, this Dave is actually sick and almost called tonight's show, except for this is for you know charity and benefits and everything else. So
yeah.
Kinda, yeah.
And the other Dave does not know how to actually run the show, so
I don't. I mean, well, right. If I knew like what all those dials and buttons did, then I would do it myself.
Yes.
Yeah.
But I would actually be in bed, and Dave could run the show by himself.
Yeah. So yeah. It'd be a hell of a different show. I can tell you that.
But unfortunately, he needs my sick ass.
But hey, what do we got next? What is the next? I think it's actually the title track.
I have
Hate Becoming.
Becoming, the title track of the CD. And this is going to be released to everyone on June 19th, correct?
Yeah, so there'll be a live show with some amazing, amazing performers, live music, album release, and it's our first fundraiser. June 19th, Hell's Kitchen, downtown Minneapolis, and you can get all the information.
Awesome fucking venue, too, by the way.
Dude,
awesome.
Are you kidding me? She used to work there. Okay, so really? Her first call. Oh, hell yeah. She did graphic art.
I didn't know that myself,
Yeah, and that was also in kind of eerie ways. It was her final gig of her life. October 6th, 2011, she was in pre-production for this album that's now called Hate Becoming. And that the reason it was her last gig is she buckled down and got in the studio and cranked this fucking thing out as she, you know, literally as she was dying, because, you know, cancer doesn't kill you in 6 months. She probably had it for years. So not to be too negative, but like she literally, this is music that was recorded while, you know, this person was fighting for her life. So I think you can hear a lot of the urgency and the intensity in the music. And this is one of my favorite tracks.
All right. Well, here is Hate Becoming.
Surrounds me quiet, I stay shh, don't let out. It's all lies left, it's all true, right? It grows stronger and the taste spits longer. Let me see, let me feel, no, no, anything but this. It takes over the all that was good and pure. It's coming now, nothing left to do to defend it. It's coming now, I pretend it while I turn away, I see.
That was Becoming.
Hate Becoming.
Oh, yes, sorry.
It was, that was Hate Becoming. That was the title track of the debut CD of Kelly Nicole. And I mean, yeah, it's going to be released on June 19th at Hell's Kitchen.
Oh my God, which is like one of my favorite venues. So.
And just so you know, it is a Monday, everybody. It's a June 19th, a Monday. And I know that
it's tough running a nonprofit. You can't always ask for a Saturday for free. So, but still, come out, come down.
I mean, you could, but.
I think Tim from, you know, Rockin' 101 in St. Cloud, they played Infected by Kelly Nicole, and I think he did say you know, June 17th there's gonna have the you know, but yeah, because that's a Saturday, but he said, you know, and that's why I actually, Teresa, I messaged you saying, okay, just to be sure, it's the 19th Monday, right? It's the 19th, yes. Right? Because I just wanted to make sure it wasn't a typo or something. But yeah,
no, Tim, June 19th, that's what it is. Yeah. Yep. And Hell's Kitchen, I want to mention, like, first of all, they're just the coolest place you'd ever want to be. Just the style and the feel of it. And then the food is just, like, ridiculous.
Oh, my God.
You'll wonder why you eat anywhere else. But these people are not taking a nickel. Like, I've never set up a nonprofit. I've never been a part of an entertainment person. I'm like a, you know, edge of the bed by myself guitar player. I've never done anything professional, and I thought I'd learn all this from Kel, watch her go, and then she's gone and it's all on my shoulders. So I'm like, I don't know how to do this. I was hoping we'd get a piece of the door. They're not taking a nickel. So, like, seriously, if you're touched by this and you live in the Twin Cities, go down to Hell's Kitchen and get a fucking burger.
Go, like, to really. I'm June 19th or anytime.
Yeah, anytime. It's just, they're just really cool people. She used to work there, and we expected they'd he and haw over it and think it over for a week and a half, and we'd maybe get a percentage of the door if we were lucky enough to use the space for free and all that, you know, that we'd come up with some kind of a deal. They wrote back the same day and said, for Kelly, done.
Well, I love that. I love that.
And you know what? I mean, I'm actually, you know, yeah, I haven't talked to the other Dave about this, but I will actually say, you know, if you want us to, you know, actually broadcast live, well, granted, Hell's Kitchen, you know, you can't really broadcast live because of where they are. But if you want us to broadcast, we are there. So,
yeah, I was going to ask about that. I mean, like, do you
let's talk about it in the background so I can go over the details. I'm trying to picture how the audio would come across and everything, but if they're cool with it, I am. You know?
Yeah, we did that for a few other shows where, like, if we could kind of tie into the soundboard and, you know, it'd broadcast. And actually, a lot of times it turns out really good. You know, like we've had bands that they use that for their promotional material now. You know, it was like, you know, something came straight out of the board. Everything sounded good and all that stuff. So, but yeah, I mean, we'd love to do that if the, you know, the venue and everyone else associated with it was, you know, I mean, if that would work.
Let's iron it out. After the show, for sure. I'll definitely jot it down.
Yeah. And we'll interview everyone involved, from you to the other two bands. Now the opening band is with the jazz trio.
The Wolverines. They've been like an institution in the Twin Cities for decades. I mean, they've got like they got 5,000 charts in their book and all this stuff. It's just ridiculous.
Well, now one of them I know. What's her?
Oh yeah.
The redhead. She
of course you know the redhead.
She used to be in like a couple of bands that I've like been associated
with. One of the singers,
with.
You mean?
Yes.
You talk about one of the singers? Oh, Rachel?
No.
She has red hair a lot of the time. Who's the redhead?
The one that lives in like Oak Grove, which is like 15 miles from me.
Well, I don't stalk them. I just like, I know of them.
Again, of course he knows the redhead.
No, I just know her and have like talked to her a few times and hung out.
I mean,
with her
his wife is a redhead, so.
But you're not talking about the drummer. You're not talking about Jen Dean.
No, oh, Jen Dean, I know really well too. I've played shows with her. Yeah.
Again.
I played bass and she played drums, and it was,
he knows the women.
It was fucking thunderous.
Oh hell yeah! Well, she okay. So back in the day, Kelly had a cover band called 40R3. And I use a lot of that footage in her documentary that'll screen that night also at Hell's Kitchen. So there'll be a movie, there'll be live music and the album and everything. Really, really special night. But Jen Dean was her drummer for ages. So she would, you know, drive Kelly's shit for years and years.
Yeah, I know. I know Jen Dean was at her. Well, do you want to call it a funeral or not? Like the.
I mean, I always say memorial, but that's probably just because I still don't.
Yeah,
you
yeah,
know, I
mean, yeah.
It's hard to deal with. So.
Well, yeah, I understand. The memorial that was at the Triple Rock. Yeah, Jen Dean was here, and I was there, and I played with her, and Krister was there, and I played with him before, and.
Were you there? I'm sorry if I don't remember. I apologize.
Yeah, I was there. I was like when you, and actually there was like a. Yeah, the band, her friends, the band played like four or five songs, right?
They played her tunes. Yeah, no vocals, no guitar solos.
Yeah,
I
was the one singing louder than anyone in the crowd.
Well, then Krister complained to you about you afterwards because he came to me after the memorial, which was, I mean, basically a rock show, if you want to think of
it
that way.
Yeah, right.
And said, I was trying to hear Kelly's voice in my head, but somebody wouldn't stop singing.
Oh, come on, Krister. I have his number. I should call him. I should call him get on him.
I actually
believe
that.
Well, let's get him
on
here right now. He'll tell some Kelly stories.
Let me see if I have his number in my phone right now.
I would even say, you know, why not call him up really quick and we can, you know, just merge
in a call.
Oh, shit,
I don't.
So.
I don't have his number.
Well, if we get a minute, I'd love to talk a little bit about how the music and the mission are kind of connected so people know where the money's going and stuff.
We always have a minute. Oh, yes. Exactly. Do you want to do it now or after the next song?
What's next, Breaking the Skin? We can do it later. As long as, like, if people only listen to the first half, I want them to at least know that when you buy Kelly's album.
We already played Breaking the Skin.
No, we didn't. Yeah. We played Hate Becoming. Before we play this song, I want to, you know, there's a message from Josh, one of my best friends ever. You know what? My oldest son is 23 years old, and Josh babysat him when he was like 9 months old. That's how long I've known this motherfucker, all right? He's one of the best guitar player and bass players that I've ever played with. And he sent a message, what was the second song that was played? But he said, he didn't know that Kelly Nicole was passed. He thought that this was a CD release show for, like, someone, you know, having a CD release show, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And he says, I'll, word for word, this is what he wrote. He says, wow, sorry for your loss. Dave Holl sent me two songs from Kelly. And I did, I you know, because I said, you got to listen to this. I sent him like a few days ago. I said, you know, and he says he sent two songs from Kelly, and I was fucking blown away by how honest and talented she was. I wish I would have met her. I'll buy recordings to support what you're doing, but wow, I was happy Dave sent me those. Some of the best music I've heard in a very long time. And this isn't just from some douche. This is from some guy that can. You put a guitar, he'll play anything that you have ever, I mean, anything. He'll just play anything once you put a guitar or bass in his hand. He's that good. So, but I mean, that's super awesome.
Yeah, she had that honesty. And I think, you know, not to get too philosophical, but I think there's a reason a lot of the great artists don't get to see, you know, 80, 85 years old and go off and retire with their wives because, like, it's a tough world. And the sensitive ones are the ones making the greatest art. And she was absolutely no exception to that rule whatsoever.
For
so
sure.
I think the sensitivity and the fact that she could sit there and sing a song like Hate Becoming and say, sitting alone, silent and all the noise. I think there's a lot of people who, whether they're survivors of some kind of a trauma or they've just struggled with depression, anxiety, mental illness, they're going to relate to her lyrics. And I think the fact that we're going to, you know, hopefully at some point in this whole thing be giving away thousands or millions of dollars to support trauma survivors and people with eating disorders, literally from the album sales and merchandise sales, I think people are going to really, really start to click into it and be like, okay, when I wear her t-shirt with her name across my heart, I'm helping save someone else's life. Like, this is fucking cool. It sucks, but it's cool. And that's what we're going for.
That is
you know, turn the darkness into something good.
That is a great way to look at it, actually. I mean, this might be saving someone else's life. Yeah.
Yeah, well, I mean, it absolutely does. Like, eating disorders are the most fatal mental illness on the planet. Everybody doesn't know that. I didn't know it. I thought for sure depression would be number one. But there is nothing with the higher mortality rate among mental illnesses than anorexia. So, you know, when she's singing and you're listening to her stuff and you're like, damn, I went to the show at Hell's Kitchen. I put $10 down and you know, at the end of the year, this foundation is going to give away a few bucks to get someone else some eating disorder treatment. Like, they can live longer and be with their family and, like, have a chance at life. Like, this is a really cool thing. I'm going to tell my friends about this. You know, so that's what we're trying to do. If you like what you're hearing and you like the music and the message and everything, KellyNicole.com. Yeah, KellyNicole.com is where to start. You can find us on social media, you know, YouTube, right. Everything. So,
And just so you know, everybody, it's spelled normal. It's spelled how you think. Kelly Nicole, mm-hmm. KELLY, and then Nicole, NICOLE. It's not a weird, you know, I always want to specify that because there are bands and there are people that like have like different, you know, odd spellings of things. You know, yeah. we're like an S has to be a Z and bullshit like that. So, but yeah, Kelly Nicole, it's spelled Kelly Nicole.
Yeah.
So, look it up and it's outstanding. It's outstanding stuff. Are we going to run with the next one right now? What song do you have lined up?
We have Breaking the Skin.
Oh, Breaking the Skin. You ready to run it?
Sorry, I'm
yeah, you are. I mean, you, yeah. Sorry. Theresa, are you there? I'm sorry. No, seriously. I totally fucked that up. I totally
did. But
did
they hear the end of the song, though?
Yeah, yeah. Yes. No, it went to the end of the song, and all of a sudden it's like static at the end of the song. I'm like, shit.
Well, we'll pretend that's part of it.
We wrote it that way. Yeah, we invented that.
Yeah.
So. Well, thanks again for having me on. I know I called you out of the blue, being like, hey, we could use some press. Do you remember Kelly?
I know. I was talking to her about that already, so... But Mike actually, first of all, I told you already on air that Josh thanked us for sharing the music with him. And now there's another guy named Mike. I don't know who this guy is. I'm just kidding. No, I know who he is. But he says it always amazes me when I hear music like this. Such talent goes unrecognized or heard. Thanks for sharing this, guys. I really enjoy the music and the show, which is like super cool. And then Josh goes on. He goes on and like actually says hi to Mike. He doesn't even say hi to us. So whatever the fuck ever. I'm just kidding. He already said hi to us. He already like, you know, messaged something cool. Now,
well, hi, Mike.
We were talking off air, Theresa.
Yeah.
And I want to kind of throw forward, you know, like my experience and what happened with meeting you and Kelly.
Yeah.
Dave, quit fucking coughing. Jesus Christ, dude. you know what's odd is that I never, ever, ever go to Craigslist for ads. I never do. I don't. And then I did. And it said, you know, like, searching for, a touring bassist for a rock band or something like that. I don't remember. So I contacted you guys.
Oh, wait a second. Hold on. Now that I'm done, like, hacking, you've never gone to Craigslist for ads.
Right.
Coming from the man that, like, spent most of his time on Backpage.
Oh, yeah, sure.
I mean, come on now.
Well, yeah, I all right, okay, well... Backpage wasn't that the thing like 20 years ago?
Yeah, well, that was like the thing is like 6 months ago. Hello.
Oh,
really?
Oh, okay. Well, right. I'm too newbie for that. So, but anyway, now there was Craigslist. I like answered the ad, and I don't know who, if it was you or Kelly who
I put it out there, and you had a video online of just singing over just your bass, doing some stuff, and I played it for Kelly. I was like, should we have this guy into the house? Like, we need to put a touring band together. You're getting ready to rock, right? This is a few months before the diagnosis. So, and then, you know, you came over to the house. So I was curious to hear your first impressions of, you know, her and the studio and everything.
Oh, my God. You know, when I got there, you guys, both of you, made me feel really comfortable to begin with. And it was in the winter. I remember that because, like, you guys, like, you know, you were in, was it North Minneapolis, Northeast or something like that?
No, it's just off 50th and Penn was our
Southeast.
Old house.
Southeast Minneapolis.
Lake Harriet-ish. And, just off Lake Harriet. Yeah.
Yeah, and so, but, I mean, you guys were kind of, like, up a hill. And it was. I remember it was winter, and it was a trek to get up that. It was like 20 feet to get up to the door.
Oh yeah.
And it's like, oh, there's ice and this and that, but luckily I am fucking nimble.
And you weren't even carrying one of her cabs. So,
right, I wasn't. I was carrying two bases.
Oh,
but
yeah.
Not a cat. But I mean, you know, I get up there and you guys like had me come in and you had me going on the super tiny narrow staircase.
Oh God.
And
22 inches, not that I remember.
Yeah, it was very skinny. and when I got down there, I'm like, wow, look at all this shit. She had, you know, screens and consoles and you know, amps and I'm just everything everywhere.
You didn't see half of it, dude. Like, the stuff that was in the garage, because it didn't fit in our house, you would just be drooling over. Because she, you know, she came up in a time. Remember, she was, like, 39 when you met her. So she came up in a time way back in the late 90s when if you had a good cover band, you could put money in your pocket every night.
Yeah, well,
And she would build up the studio over the years. So it was really quality
stuff.
Yeah,
and that's what I'm doing now, actually. I'm doing cover band things just to make money.
Yeah.
You know, but when I was there, the first thing, like when I saw all of that shit, the first thing I thought of was like, how the fuck did they get that down that tiny ass stairway?
Dude, I mean, really, I'm not even going to talk about it.
It was like, really, I mean, it was like so much cool shit, you know. But I sat down with her, and I know you left for a while. Mm-hmm. And I sat down with her, and she says, you know, and you know, we talked for, you know, just, you know, jibber jabber for a little bit. And then she played me some of her stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, she played me a handful of songs, and it was cool. I mean, she like even like did stuff with like the, you know, like the, you know, whatever you call it, the mixing stuff.
And, oh, really?
Okay. And no, but
so she, it's that mixing stuff.
Well, yeah, I mean, it was only on a couple of them, because most of them were mixed pretty close to what you wanted. But some of them, she's like, okay, here's how this is. And if I like press this button and did this fader and did this, this is how it would sound this way. And I'm like, well, fuck. I mean, I didn't know what to say. It's cool either way. I don't know.
Well, that's because you don't know what any button does.
Well,
so.
No, I could hear a slight difference. Yeah, I could hear a difference, and I liked them both. You know, so.
Dude, she could hear, let me tell you for one second what Kelly could hear. She's in the backseat of the car one day. We're driving down the highway, and we're listening, this Katy Perry song comes on, and Kelly's, can you guys hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you fine, but Dave won't stop fucking coughing.
And the song comes on, she goes, oh, I want that mic. I was like, oh, did you read about this or something? She goes, no, I can hear it. It's a fucking manly gold. I want that mic. And I was like, Kel, I love you, but you can't hear the microphone on the radio with the highway road noise and everything. I just don't believe
you
anymore.
Oh, yes,
you
can.
I went home and looked it up, and then she was right. Like, she can pick out the mic on the radio that they're using in the middle of mass production pop music. Like,
yeah,
you know, I mean, it was just uncanny. She could hear
everything. That's something that I heard on the documentary that I saw, and we'll get to that later.
Oh, I'm glad you checked it out.
So, oh, I check out everything because I check out everything when it's cool.
Well, that'll be there at the night, too. So June 19th, people are going to see that on the big speakers in the middle of Hell's Kitchen. Like, yeah. Hopefully hundreds of people will check that out.
It was, yeah, I mean, the document was cool, and you were there, and you were speaking, and you were like, you knew what you were doing. You, like, you owned the screen.
Dude, that was rough time. So that was August, and, you know, she passed in August. She passed on our anniversary.
Oh, you did that right away?
No. We did it 1 year after. So
oh, one
Kelly,
year. Okay.
Kelly
I was going to say,
on
wow.
August 16th, which was sure. Our second anniversary.
Sure.
And then she needed a memorial. We put that together at Triple Rock. And then we dove into the album artwork. And then her best friend called me up one night and was like, we should do a small promotional video, but we shouldn't do it ourselves. Like, let's not suck. And I said, okay, that's a good rule. Let's not suck. And so I looked around and asked in her network of people she knew, like, does anyone know a filmmaker? And we ended up finding this amazing guy named Justin Staggs. He did her music video for Infected, which you'll see on June 19th at Hell's Kitchen.
Oh, I can't wait for that.
Documentary. Oh, yeah, dude. He did both of them, and it's pro. It's really pro.
So it's like an actual video.
Oh, for sure. Yeah, the Infected video, that's, you know, we went up to the woods in St. Paul, this Roseville, some kind of reservoir place, and shot a for real video, big crew and everything. So
I got in trouble in Roseville before.
A few months after she was gone. So I was still really raw when all that documentary, when that was shot, it was still very new for me, and I had to, you know,
sure,
of course,
sure.
I forgot half of what I wanted to say, but, you know, we cut it together. It's all about the edit.
No, that's cool. I mean, I can't wait to see that. I was infected, you know, ever since I met you guys. And, you know, she was like showing me stuff and, you know, having me listen to music. There's only a couple of things where she says, well, I like this or I like this version. And you can hear it a little different, but, they, you know, they both sounded good to me. I mean, they sounded good.
Yeah.
They're both thunderous. Yeah. And, you know, and I'm here for an audition. This is a bass audition, right? Mm-hmm. And so, like, we actually sat and talked for like 45 minutes. Mm. I don't know. Was it that long? I don't know. You know. Maybe was it 9 hours? I can't really remember. But you know, but we talked for about a lot of things, like what do you expect out of this, and what, you know, like, you know, I mean, just tons of things, you know, and mostly, do you like the music? And I said, yes, it's I love it. Yeah. And then I said at the end, I said, you know what? All right, well, I'll grab my bass. I can show you some things that I can do. I can play some really cool stuff. Do you want me to like do this? And she says, nope. You know, you're the guy I want if you want to do it. And wow. I said, well, no. I mean, I can play for you. And she says, no. I mean, I saw some videos of you. I talked to people around town and stuff. I know you can play. I just wanted to talk to you and make sure that you were like on the same page and we're all gonna be, you know. And I'm thinking that's, you know. I mean, yeah. Cool. I mean, because I felt the exact same way.
Yeah. Well, you got to click. Like, you're always talking about band chemistry. Like, I don't care how good of musicians two people are. If they don't click, it's going nowhere. So she was looking
really?
For, after all the, you exactly, know, after all yeah. her health problems her whole life, like, who's going to have my back? Who can go on this tour with me? And, like, they're going to stick through this because, you know, Kelly didn't have an easy life. She, the eating disorder, you know, being malnourished. Imagine being on tour and like, living on, you know, a few calories a day. You can't do it. But that was her life. So,
yeah.
Again, that's why when people buy the record, we're going to try to help other people get a shot at their dreams. So
now,
I hope they dig it.
Was she, when I first met her,
uh-huh.
And I think it was like 2 or 3 months before you messaged me and other people saying that, you know, like the cancer either came back or she had something that, you know.
Oh, it was, no, we didn't fucking know she had cancer. That oh. that diagnosis was a bombshell.
Oh,
no,
really? Really? Wow.
Oh, yeah,
wow.
yeah, yeah. So that was February 21st. was the diagnosis, and then she made it 6 more months. So we went from, you know, all her dreams at her fingertips, the albums coming together, the touring bands hanging out in our house, we're talking to people, you're learning your parts, to, I'm so sorry, you have cancer everywhere, enjoy the rest of your time together.
Yeah.
And then she was gone in 6 months.
That's,
so it's
yeah,
it's
it was very
one.
Quick. Yeah, it was very quick. I mean, it wasn't
well,
something
it was
that...
everywhere by the time they admitted that she was sick. And that's where the PTSD part comes in, because a lot of doctors aren't trained on the adult health effects of childhood trauma, and they don't know to look for diseases of the aging population in people who are 35, 38, 39. And, you know, the average age of diagnosis for ovarian cancer, what Kelly died of, is 61 years old, and Kelly died at 40. So what our message is with the foundation, KellyNicole.com, is trauma makes a big difference, and you have to start looking at people as human beings with a biography and a whole life that's building up into different health risks. And we, that's
sure.
part of the story that we want to tell through her music and through, you know, the mission is you can't just assume because someone's 39 years old that they can't have a disease of older people, because Kelly lived a lot of years in those 39 years, if you know what I'm saying.
Right. Oh, I totally know what you're saying.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, even though I've like already, you know, been, you know, kind of part of it and been past it. I mean,
oh, yeah.
you talking about it like makes it sad again. I mean, not sad. I mean, it is sad again, but at the same time, you got to like talk about it like, you know, hey, like get past it and let's talk about the next step, you know, like as far as now, is it Kelly Nicole Foundation? Is that .org or .com?
So we've got our bases covered. She owned KellyNicole.com, and that passed to me because they legalized marriage equality in Minnesota. Otherwise,
sure.
I would have no rights, and there would be no foundation. There'd be nothing. So thank you, Minnesota, for that.
At least there's that. Yeah,
yeah. So yeah, KellyNicole.com and KellyNicoleFoundation.org.
Oh, that's
exactly
the one that
same.
Was .org. Okay, Kelly Nicole
exactly
Foundation.
The same website.
Okay.
Yeah, it's we just wanted to cover our bases. So. I say KellyNicole.com so that people remember it faster.
Yeah, that is easier to remember, yes.
It's a little snappier, yeah.
Snap.
Snappy.
But, no, but yeah, I mean, it was the first time I've ever met you guys. I told you that last time I talked to you was very few times do I feel that comfortable meeting someone the first time.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I mean, like people like people's grandparents or something. You know, it's like, well, I mean, it kind of in the same way. It's totally different. It's totally different. You know, it's like, oh, hi, how are you? What have you, what have you been up to? And how, you know, have you been? What do you do for a living? This and that, you know, like, you know, grandparents. But for Kelly, Kelly had the same, to me, had the same feel. But she wasn't, you know, she was like, so, what do you got going on? How are you doing? And what's, I mean, you know, like kind of, but it is still like, it wasn't like just some person just saying, dude, what's up, you know? But,
yeah.
You know, she like really had, I mean, she, I don't know. It was like, it's not even really anything I can explain. Is that stupid or not? I don't know.
No, like she put people at ease, and she put me at ease. She
Very
made
much.
especially artists. You know, she had produced artists for a lot of years, so I learned from her. When someone walks in through your front door to be creative, like light some candles, chill out. The mood and the energy in the room is going to affect their output, and she was a master of that. So she knew how to make everyone feel good, and it was always genuine. Like she wasn't a bullshit small talker, and that's what I miss the most, because so much of life is. I hate to say it, but like so much of life is fake and not as genuine, not as authentic because people put a face on. And
Yeah.
she was just like the most authentic person you'd ever want to know
Actually,
in your
very
whole life, you
much.
know?
Yeah, very much. And I am guilty of that, being like the bullshit small talker. Hey, how's it going? And like pretending that I care. And it's like, okay, well, hey, I gotta go over here, but yeah, good job. Hey, you know, nice to meet you or whatever. You know, like, you know, in the back of your mind, it's like, fuck off, I gotta go do this.
Well, that's a sweet thing. Like, if she looks you in the eye and says, how have you been? Like, you can see that she cares. You can see that it's really
Very
there.
much. I felt so comfortable with her the first, and actually the second time I came to meet you guys was when there was a rehearsal and someone couldn't make it, so it was canceled, but it was already like,
All right.
I was already like three quarters of the way there, so we like hung out and talked again, and just it, we just talked, and you made me and Kelly like some spicy chicken rice thing.
Well, then you saw, I know you weren't sitting there thinking, oh, she must have an eating disorder, but like, I miss making her food
Yeah.
because not just because anyone would miss their family, but because like, I thought for sure, based on her history, if we can get food into this girl, we'll have some kind of a future together. We'll have some shot.
Yeah.
Maybe we don't get 50 years together, but I thought we'd get more than three. And
Right.
so
And it
I'm
seemed
glad you remember those little
Yeah,
sweet little
and
moments of trying to get her fed.
I didn't know, so I didn't really pay too much attention because I've always, you know, I mean, I've always been around girls who don't finish their food and stuff, but I mean, I don't know, she ate. You know, she ate, you know, I didn't, I mean, I scarfed mine down, of course. You know, me being the two,
Shocker.
yeah, me being the 230-pound eater, right?
Well, it's funny you said I made you feel comfortable. I can believe she did, but I was not trying to make you feel comfortable because you're twice the size of my wife.
Yeah.
And like, we're trying to get this van put together, right? And but at the same time, it's like there's going to be all these strange guys hanging out with my wife, and I'm going to be upstairs and won't be able to hear anything. So I'd lurk behind the drum set. Do you remember? I'd just kind of lurk into the room for no reason now and then I'd
Oh,
leave again.
I didn't notice that. I actually did not notice that because I had my
It's
back.
funny.
You know, I had my back to. I mean, after a while, I know you like came down and you know, like you two were like really genuine together. Like, you know, you two were beautiful together.
Oh, thank you.
Very. I mean, really. I mean, I am I like that? I mean, I shouldn't even say this on air. I mean, I'm not like that with my wife. I'm really not.
Well,
I
Kelly's
that.
that way.
Was
Like,
that
you can't not
oh,
be.
Dave is looking at me and shaking his hand, saying that was the stupidest fucking thing you could say on air ever.
We're both affectionate people. We know we're sensitive people, and I think we clicked from the first instant.
Yeah,
So,
I mean, and well, you yeah, you
yeah.
said you met her at Guitar Center.
Yeah, she sold me a vocal mic.
Okay, yeah. Oh no, actually, you didn't tell me that. That was part of your like at the memorial. You said that.
Oh,
Yeah.
is it part of the eulogy? Okay,
That's how
yeah.
I remember it. Yeah. So, but hell, you know, I mean, it's, this is, I mean, I don't know. And I'm talking about her more than, seriously, we do not talk this much about our artists
Yeah.
ever. I mean, I'm just like, oops, sorry. I'm not sorry. I wasn't like talking into the mic like I should. I'm just like kind of hanging out and just like turning in my chair and stuff, you know? So, all right. Sorry about that, Dave. So for the last like 10 minutes, I probably was really quiet.
No, it sounds good on my side, but I'm not monitoring, so.
I mean, yeah, it was just a great experience, and I'm really, yeah, it's really, I don't know, is it upsetting or sad or I mean, I would have loved to attend. I mean, I would have loved to, like, even if we like played like just enough to make gas money to get to the next town or something like that. I would have loved to have just gone and played those songs.
Oh yeah. Oh hell yeah.
You know, it was just fun. It was, you know, me playing in the basement and like, you know, like learning all the songs and stuff like that.
Yeah.
All right, what are we doing? Yeah, turn on your mic and so you can tell me.
Well, my mic is on. Hello. No, take my pills.
Oh, yeah.
You want me to set this up for a second? Or
yes,
or?
Please.
Actually, can I a little bit? You can, like, go, because I watched the documentary.
Oh, okay. Oh. I'm going to let you hit it. If you get a fact wrong, I'll just step in.
Yes. Well, no, actually,
the timeline is I'll
say what I think I know, and then you just finish it all. You just finish it okay. all. No, really. Right. Now, who was it that was talking on the document? Was it Justin? Was it Jew?
Where
he said that this was something that was like Kelly wrote this song and it's like, hey, sing and play this song, let's record it. She kind of didn't
You're talking about her producer,
was
Harley.
A producer?
Okay. James Harley, yeah.
Yeah, and she didn't want to do it at first. Now, did this happen like a few months before she died?
So I'll walk you through the timing without making it take too long. So it was like the first or second Friday in February 2015. Like Kelly's like, I'm not ready. I'm not ready. And I know she's a perfectionist. So I'm seeing this album slipping through our hands because like, it just is. She's looking so sick. She never wants to go anywhere. And like, we got a track. We got to keep the producer knowing that we're serious and everything. So I was like, well, let's just have the producer over on Friday. And if you don't like what you record, we'll call it a rehearsal. Okay, we can always hit delete. So let's just track no matter what. And she's like, something's wrong. And 2 weeks later, we get the diagnosis and she lives 6 more months. So when you hear Take My Pills, you know, this is truly the swan song. This is the last words that she ever sang into a microphone. And, you know, you can hear the album ends with I'm done running away from this. And I think there's no more powerful message for trauma survivors than no matter what the fuck you went through, there's no recovery in hiding from it. You have to face whatever's going on. I have to get up every morning and know that I'm not going to see her today. And I have those words that she sang as my guide. You know, I have to live up to her courage to be the leader of this organization. So sorry to talk over you.
You know more of the intimate details than I do. I mean, from what I know is that, she was kind of second guessing. I don't want to do this song right now. And it was recorded. Now, to my understanding, it was her with the guitar and singing just by herself. And then things were added later, like a little bit.
So she didn't play the
guitar.
She did the vocal
this one. Oh, she did. Yeah. Okay. She did the vocal. Yeah. And now what Jew.
Can you explain that? Because it sounds really bad on the radio.
All right. This is what I know from listening to the documentary. All right.
We sound really bad.
Yeah. Well, Kelly, to my understanding, had a brother named Justin.
Yeah.
And then her musician friend, was he the bass player or not?
Guitar keys. Engineer.
Yeah. His name was Justin as well, but she's not going to have two Justins in her life. So she started calling him Jew. J-U.
Exactly, yeah.
J-U, Justin, yeah.
Because really bad when we don't spell it out.
So any of you, juicers out there, settle down.
Oh, brother.
So,
he did the arrangement. He wrote the string part. It's kind of his baby, too.
Okay,
because there's
like cool stuff in the background. But, yeah, and he even stated that she didn't have quite the power that she always does.
Yeah, and because her producer came over and was like, you can't get any air. We only gave her 2 takes because she just couldn't fucking breathe. And then 2 weeks later, we find out, she wasn't supposed to live through March. And that was tracked in February. So that tells you, like, the dedication to the art.
So she ended up going, like 4 or 5 months past
what she was supposed to. Yeah, we worked our asses off, you know, made every type of if it can be juiced, I've fucking juiced it. Like, we tried everything.
That's what I'm telling. That's what I'm getting to is that I like that. Now she didn't quite have her power, all right, but she still had like a little bit of a breathy vocal and soul though, and that can never be fucking duplicated.
Yeah, why would you want to? Like, yeah, only people are going to track their masterpiece when they're almost dead. Like, it's just never going to happen.
Exactly. I know. And the fact that it was, like, put at the end of the CD, I think, because that's the only song that I've never heard before. Mm. The other eight, I had them. And I even had, like, a couple different songs, like, Off the Floor and stuff like that.
I love that song.
But I do, too. That's the next CD.
Oh, yeah.
She had that, you know, I mean, you can't duplicate that. And even though you can tell that it is not produced the same way as the other eight songs, I love the fact I mean, even though I never heard the song before, I wanted you to put that on there. I love the fact that you put that song on the end of the CD, because it's her last, well, like you said, it's her last ever recorded song, but it's different. It's different, but it's still good, but it's just different. I mean,
it's,
I don't know.
Two takes, and it's just raw grit, raw strength. Yeah. You know? I mean, she was like, we weren't going anywhere at this point. Like,
she was pushing as hard as she could, and it's something that
she could.
That can never be duplicated. It can never, ever be duplicated.
And when you buy the album at KellyNicole.com, you're giving someone else a chance at their own future. So, you know, listen to her voice and help someone else find their voice. So I really appreciate everyone's support tonight.
Sure. Well, I mean, Theresa, it was a pleasure speaking with you.
Oh, yeah. Well, thank you so much.
And we are going to play... we're going to play that song, Take My Pills. We're going to play Take My Pills. And, you know, once again, tell us how to, I mean, we have the June 19th show.
Yeah.
That's going to, I mean, you're going to release your songs, right?
Going to release the album. There'll be great live music. Of course, the food at Hell's Kitchen is outstanding, and we're hoping to raise a few $1,000 and start to chip away at these expenses and get towards the dream of handing out, you know, big checks at the end of every year to organizations that support trauma survivors and people with eating disorders. So, like, if you listen to the lyrics on this song, you know that when you buy the music, you're helping someone else who suffers exactly the way she's singing about. And I've never heard of another organization where when you buy the music, you're paying to help someone else, you know, with the pain that you're hearing. Like, I've just never heard of anything like this before. So I think it's unique, and I hope people get into it. And honestly, she's an amazing artist, and she deserves to be heard.
That's awesome.
Hey, thanks, you guys.
So
KellyNicole.com is where you can find everything. Link out to buy your tickets, social media, it's all there.
So who are the other bands on the bill that night?
Yeah, so Wolverines Jazz Trio, local institution, local legend, will be featuring singers Lori Dokken, Rachel Holder-Hennig, Patty Peterson, the great Debbie Duncan, and Judy Vinar, and they're all amazing.
Lori Dokken, that's the one that I know.
Oh, she's
I know
not
her.
A redhead.
Oh, no, 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 you're right, you're right, she's not. Actually, I played with her once. her nephew, Jason Dieter, is one of my best friends, and we went to her, like, show, because she's an outstanding piano player, too.
Oh, God.
And, so, we went out to, like, one of her shows, and, like, Jason and I did a duet on a bunch of stuff, and she played piano.
Well, she's in the foundation. Like, we're texting back and forth all the time, like, what else can we be doing? And she's got a lot of amazing ideas for the future vision. So she's part of this group, and she was there in Kelly's final days and was able to say what she had to say. Yeah, this is from the heart, like nothing you've ever been a part of. Like, when we say this is from the heart, like the logo on the album cover, Hate Becoming, Kelly Nicole, right? I'm sorry, not the logo, the font. The font on her nameplate on her studio monitor where I put her ashes. Like, it doesn't get any more from the heart than that font is on my own urn. Because I put her studio monitors, my name on one and her name on the other. And that's how it's going to be for all eternity. So
I love,
like,
that.
This,
yeah. I remember being at her memorial, and she had like a studio monitor, and that was her urn. Like, yeah, her ashes was inside there. Yeah.
Yeah, she's with the music forever. So, and also, Late Night Fights is a rock group that everybody should be checking out. They've got a new release called Renal 911, R-E-N-A-L, Renal 911. So,
definitely
check out their stuff there online too. Late Night Fights. They're gonna be closing us out. So it'll be jazz from 6 to 7:30, and then I'll screen the documentary I Want You to Hear Me, the Kelly Nicole story, at 8, and then from like roughly 8:45 until 10, you'll get the hard rock. So come on down, buy the record, have a burger, and if you can throw $1 in the donation box, I'd be very grateful.
Oh hell yeah
Stand up and shout.
Stand up and shout.
Yeah. Right. Well, thanks, you guys. I appreciate it so much, more than you know.
Well, hey, Theresa, you are so awesome. Every time I've ever met you and talked to you, You're so outstandingly awesome.
Well, thanks, man. It's only the beginning, right?
Yeah, I hope so. I want to be like part of the ride as much as I can.
Yeah, well, there'll be more music, and there'll be, you know, fundraisers every year. We're going to be at Pride after this, so if you absolutely can't make it Monday night downtown, June 19th, we'll be at Pride later that Saturday and Sunday the following week. So come down and check out the booth and pick up the CD.
I plan on being at the 19th, and you know, at the very least, it'll be late. I mean, if I have to ump a game, but I'm for sure going to be there.
All right, man, I appreciate it.
All right, well, here is Take My Pills.
This is a beautiful song.
I hate the way I feel, and I feel
That was Take My Pills by Kelly Nicole. That's the last track on her CD that's, that you are going to be able to hear on June 19th at Hell's Kitchen. Come out there. It's going to be a cool everything. Teresa, what else do we have? You know, you have like flash drives that that.
Oh, wait, hold on a second.
Start over. Just wait. Ready?
Somebody has to actually like plug you into the phone.
Sorry.
Hello.
I screwed
up. Can
you hear me? All right. Yep. Yes, now you can. All right.
Sorry. I had a home office when we were just living our regular life. She walks in the door one day to just steal a kiss or whatever. And she goes, I'm releasing my album on flash drives. People aren't listening to me on shitty MP3s. Walks back out of the room. And, you know, months later, it's all blown up and she's gone. And so I try to hold on to these memories of what she wanted and the artistic qualities that she wanted to have WAV files out. And so what we've done is if you look at kellynicole.com/rock, I got these dog tag flash drives and had actually stainless steel dog tabs stamped with all these beautiful words and her name and everything. So you can actually wear her album and the documentary that you see that night around your neck. Those are collectible. I only made 100 of them. So when they're gone, I'll get more. But, you know, seriously, be one of the first to wear an album around your neck that saves someone else's life. I hope to see everybody there on June 19th. KellyNicole.com for all the information, all the social media. We're everywhere. And then on that night as well, she'll be everywhere you buy the music you love. She'll be on, you know, iTunes, Spotify, all the digital partners. We're doing it up. Our saying inside the foundation internally is we're Coca-Cola. Even though no one's ever heard of us before, we run it like a billion-dollar outfit because we care about her, and we hope that it gets to be that someday. So thanks for having me on. This is like, I know that we're like nobody right now, but hopefully someday that'll be different.
Oh, yeah, blow it up. But Teresa, you're awesome.
Yeah. Well, thanks, Dave.
And you were an awesome interview. You were fucking great.
I appreciate it. I've been nervous. Like,
yeah. Oh, yeah. You should be nervous. Yeah. You should be scared of us. you know what? We are going to, even though this song was not originally going to be played, we're going to play the song Needing More to lead us out. Lead us out tonight. And I love this song. And it's heavy and thunderous. And then it's like fun. And then it's thunderous again. And then it's fun. And then it's going to kick you in the nuts.
Yeah. Yep.
And then Dave's going to figure out how to start the song.
Yeah, the album is Hate Becoming. Comes out June 19th. Thanks, everybody.
Yeah, you are awesome. Rock and roll. Is it starting yet?
Yeah.
right, that was Kelly Nicole. One of my favorite songs, Needing More. We still have Theresa.
Hello, Theresa.
The executive director of the Kelly Nicole Foundation on the line. We are signing out. Is there anything that you want to... Hey, you got to turn that shit off, dude. All right. Is there anything you want to sign off with?
Myself?
Yeah.
Oh, me? Oh, geez.
I can do that.
I just want to thank everybody for listening and listening to her music and listening to something that's a little different than the usual, right? Kind of a nonprofit music situation that we've got here. And just if anybody's struggling with PTSD or their relationship with food or any kind of mental illness, just, you know, let's just remember to kind of be easy on each other, because everyone's fighting a battle that you can't see and they have physical consequences. So even though, like, it'll always say cancer on her death certificate, like, I think that her future was taken away a long time ago, and let's give somebody else their future back. So I'll see you guys on June 19th at Hell's Kitchen for a great cause, and let's make it rock.
Theresa, you are awesome, and that's, I couldn't have said it better. I really couldn't have said it better. I would have fucked it up. But hey, everybody, June 19th, I hope to see you out there, because I plan on being out there.
Yeah,
if we can get things worked out with the venue, we might be broadcasting live June 19th, and it is a Monday, just so everyone knows.
It's a sleepy Monday until you hear that music. It'll wake you right up.
But it is a holiday, so you don't have to go to work the next day. You can even ask me. So yeah, if any of your bosses say, "Hey, how come you haven't been to work Tuesday the 20th?" Just say, "Well, Dave said so." and we're okay then. All right. So, but thanks, Theresa. I'm Dave.
And I'm Dave.
And we are peacing out.
Peace out.
And we will see you. Well, actually, not next Wednesday, because you are moving. This is actually our last show.
This is our last show for a month. Yes, exactly.
So, hell yeah. We will see you next time. And... do I love you all or do I hate you all?
You love us.
Right.
So long, sucker!